Introduce. Yeah, I'm just introducing. Huh? Do an introduction.
Okay.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. At the outset, I extend a warm welcome to all the participants of this webinar on a very interesting topic: learn while you earn. While you earn. We have with us Mr. Muralidharan, who is the General Manager, HR Resources of Ashok Leyland, who has been involved in this program right from the start. And Ashok Leyland, as you are aware, has successfully initiated this project at its Panthnagar plant, and it is in the third year of its operation. And this scheme is very much being looked at in detail, and Saint-Gobain is doing it. NTTF is an active partner in both these ventures. Other companies are also looking at this model. So we hope you have a good interaction with Mr. N. Muralidharan. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thanks to CII for giving me this opportunity to present our experiences in this very interesting field. So I have captioned it as Skilling the Unskilled. This is a scheme which we started 5 years back in our greenfield unit at a place called Panthnagar in the state of Uttarakhand. So let me just give you a little bit of a micro and a macro level context, which was the basis on which facilitated the start of this scheme and our experience so far in the last 4 years. Just to go to the beginning, let me start by answer the question how it all started. The context was that we were setting up a state-of-the-art manufacturing facility at Panthnagar, the state of Uttarakhand, and this was going to be the most modern plant of Ashok Leyland, deploying the latest technology, the most contemporary technology, that with a huge investment resource of about 2,000 crores was pumped into this plant, and we're looking at ramping up the facility to about 50,000 to 75,000 trucks. And this plant also was not just going to produce the current models, it was even the new generation vehicles which we were planning, which were on the drawing board at that point of time. We thought it's the place where we will productionize all these models. Of course, the advantages were there was a huge tax concession, sales tax concessions, a tax holiday of 10 years, which was certainly going to help us in terms of improving our market share and bottom line. So like many others, we also made a kind of an entry into this state. And like other industries like PML, Tata Motors and Mahindra, we also set up the facilities. And when we went there, of course, the scenario was that there was a tremendous demand supply gap in terms of skilled manpower, because basically we have to understand that Uttarakhand state was rather a backward state industrially. It was basically an agrarian type of an economy which was suddenly getting very active on the industrial front because of the slew of concessions which the state government was willing to extend. So if you look at the technical education scenario, we found that we had very few technical institutions, and again the quality of products of these institutions left much to be desired. In fact, one startling fact that came to our notice was, even at plus two stage, only 3 to 5% of the students were actually taking mathematics as a subject. So you can just understand the type of challenges we had in recruiting or engaging or training technical manpower. And of course, we have to certainly depend on the local supply of skills, because Uttarakhand being a state, a backward state I would say, where the migration of labor from other states is not going to be so easy. And even on the civic front, there are a lot of issues. Infrastructure was just developing, housing, schools, etc., etc., even kind of social activity in the evenings which youngsters are looking for. There was a huge deficit in all these areas, because this is a kind of a place which was trying to evolve industrially from a kind of an agrarian society. And Of course, as like all state governments, this government also wants the local talent to be employed. And of course, we as an industry were willing, but the issue that confronted was, where is the pipeline that ensures the right type of skills, both in terms of quality and quantity? So I am also looking at a little broader perspective, a macro level environment which we are faced with. We have this restrictive labor laws. Then there is a work culture which is marked by negative unionism. There is a yawning gap, as I mentioned, between what we require and the actual skill sets available from the technical institutions. And we have a conundrum here where industry is starved of talent and people are starved of opportunities. And there was lack of flexibility in terms of aligning people, resource to our requirements. Of course, on a broader societal level, there is inequality or unequal opportunity distribution between those who could afford the education and those who have the intent but have no means to access education and to certain opportunities. Productivity were far below the accepted levels, negotiated many times and ends up at suboptimal level. The workforce is generally divided into management and workmen, and these two distinct groups normally act as adversaries. And there was always a lack of joint ownership of organization. So how do we address these macro level issues? And generally the traditional path has been address the skill gap through technician route with ITI and apprenticeship training. And of course, you would all agree with me, there is a tremendous gap between the technical training which these guys undergo in their institutions and the competencies we require in a state of art manufacturing environment. And of course, there has been the need for retraining and retraining, which involves substantial period of time. Just to quote our own example, we take diploma holders from the best institutions through a very rigorous selection process. Even that kind of a creamy layer of talent, we need about 2 years of training and orientation and investment in terms of time and resources before they become really industry ready and start contributing to us. So normally these ITI technicians whom the industries recruit start and end as workmen, because this is something to do with the mindset also. Industries also expect them to behave like workmen, and they behave like workmen. It's something like a self-fulfilling prophecy. There is a limitation in terms of growth, and even if somebody has an aspiration to get into managerial or supervisory level, the system doesn't allow normally. So there is opportunity to a large majority of population, including girls, who do not have access to technical education in the state of Uttarakhand, was one factor which we reckon. Especially youth from hill districts, they do not get access to quality technical education because of the economic and social background. So we had a very classical chicken and egg syndrome. The industry needs experienced people, but vast number of people are there with so-called technical education, but they do not gain experience because they are not industry ready. So here we have a paradox. Industry is starved of skilled manpower, whereas there is unemployment of so-called educated manpower. So how do we really address this issue was something which we did a lot of brainstorming. Then another interesting dimension we looked at was knowledge and skills are important, certainly, but more important is also the attitude. See, once we recruit somebody as a workman with a particular mindset as workman, we find normally that it becomes very restrictive. It becomes difficult for us to change his mindset, or nor he also finds it difficult, because we don't also expect him to change. So we thought when we put this state-of-the-art facility at Pantnagar with the latest in terms of manufacturing technology, latest in terms of productivity practices, why not look at something which is also very innovative and state-of-the-art as far as human resources strategy is concerned. And we, having been in this field for the last 60 years, we had put up 4 or 5 plants across the country, and some lessons in terms of culture building we have also learned. So we thought, why don't we shed the baggage of the past and legacy issues and build a strong foundation of a positive culture? Apart from building skills and knowledge, why not develop a positive culture through bit of attitude building? So why don't we look at building a high work performance culture and engage people to achieve business results. So we also looked at certain degree of cultural visioning and building self-directed work teams and giving people empowerment and autonomy. So in short, we were just telling ourselves that we need to empower people, make them think big, make them take pride in this facility where they are going to get engaged. So how do we turn the conventional wisdom on its head was one question which we brainstormed. So what is that we want to be different when it comes to HR practices in this plant? More so when we are looking at the next level practices in manufacturing, supply chain or quality. So we came up with an idea of an integrated workforce. When you talk of integrated workforce, it doesn't mean that everybody is equal. Yes, people will be different. There will be different roles to be performed. Not everybody will get the same salaries. Not everybody will carry the same responsibility. But we would like to look at bringing people together and compress the divide that exists between the so-called management and workmen. So how do we create a mindset of associates in co-owning and co-creating the organization visions? So yeah, the normal thinking is the shop people who work on the shop floor, the category of workmen, generally they felt inferior because of lesser education and growth opportunities.
In earlier days, we had separate canteens and uniforms, which further reinforced the difference. So this has created a we versus they perception and a kind of a class divide. So one question that came to our mind, or which we debated, was when a workman has an issue or a grievance, why he doesn't come to his supervisor or a manager? Why he goes to union? Is the question which we asked ourselves. The question is, the issue is that, yes, they don't have trust in us. So how do we build that trust? Maybe this route we will take, not only to build the competencies and skills, but also to build the trust and bring people together as a team. So we said it's important to create common facilities, importantly equal opportunities. The other area is on the kind of growth opportunities. Once somebody is inducted as workman, should he retire only as a workman? Even though he has aspirations, even though he is willing to learn, even though he is willing to stretch himself and take responsibility. So if we have that positive element of thinking in him, why don't we harness it? So why don't we build upon it? Why should we treat everybody in a kind of a stereotype, mental stereotype, that once he comes as a workman, generally workmen shirk responsibility, they need to be controlled, they need to be closely supervised. Can we break this concept? So why not we look at equal opportunities for shop floor associates also to learn, contribute and grow? So can we look at giving a kind of a challenge to the stereotype model, once a workman, always a workman? So based on this brainstorming and discussions, we thought we will develop something called 21st century factory credo. We call it as 21st century factory credo. So what should be a contemporary factory in 21st century look like? What should be its essential features? So how do we, first thing as I told you, how do we bring down this class conflict between workmen and management? Then this concept of white collar and blue collar workmen or associates. How do we bring them together? Then why the workmen do not want the organization objectives? So how do we create an environment or a facilitate an atmosphere where they will be able to own up the organization objectives? And why a workman goes to his union and not his supervisor, a basic cultural question we asked. And how do we make him, not necessarily, maybe if required, why a union should also be there? Suppose if all of us feel responsible and are treated as equal and look at helping us each other, then maybe there may not be a need for union. Because I am not telling that I am not against a union, but I am looking at why a workman cannot take charge of his own destiny. Why can't he look at himself being a part of the management and the total corporate team? And another thing we find that in personal capacity, people generally respect quality, cost, harmony. But when it comes to workplace, somehow, you know, this is missing. And many times we find the work agenda is all negotiated and not self-owned.
So this is just to a broader take on when people are divided into a kind of a hierarchy and a class divide as management and workmen. Suddenly we have to understand that there are unequal opportunities for both growth and development. Then we have a classic example of a supervisor who is a fresher from agra engineering college supervising people who are experienced in the line, not able to command the respect. Then limited brand in employment market, job security many times comes from law. See, one reason why workmen continue to remain as workmen, you ask them, there are a lot of fears in their mind. What happens to a security? Suppose we become an executive. Even earlier in our own organization, when we are trying to give opportunities to associates for growth as executives, there was some resistance because the so-called security, which they will lose because they have no more the protective umbrella of union is there. Today you become responsible for the results, you will be held accountable, and maybe decisions will be taken on rewarding people. Everybody will not be treated, there will be differentiation amongst people. So how do we build in this security, the concept of security coming from your competence? So how do you bring in the concept of employability more than, rather than a narrow view of what is a current employment? So that is one thing which we wanted to address. And career growth, we said, should come through competence towards individual motivation and aspirations, and not through just negotiation and coercion. And also, as I said, why should be that once somebody joins as workman, we should always remain as workman? Why can't we look at giving him an opportunity or create a model for development? So this 21st century factory credo, which we thought would be a kind of a HR framework in this new plant, says that all employees are respected as equal members, contributing to a common cause of benchmarked excellence. And this integrated workforce will have these features. There is trust, bonding, there is a positive mindset, there is a culture of mutual respect. We are looking at very contemporary work systems and processes. There is a world-class infrastructure. There is going to be tremendous freedom and empowerment, irrespective of the level at which people will be engaged. And of course, people can join at a particular level, but then there will not be limits, they can grow. We'll give them a path. And there will be, of course, trials and triumphs as we set up this plant. And another important point which we thought we should recognize was that we should look at diversity and inclusiveness. In fact, there is a lot of pitch we have made on gender diversity. In fact, in this plant, in fact, our policy is that at least 30% of the workforce should be women, and we are trying to meet that. It's a target which is not statutory. In fact, the political parties have not been able to pass this legislation of 1/3 members of the parliament being women. But this is a kind of a goal which we have set for ourselves. It's a vision of our management, top management, I would say. Why not we promote diversity by bringing in 30%? And we have tried to see, to the extent possible, how do we go on increasing this number and spread. And there has to be, of course, an atmosphere of celebration as we reach the different milestones. This, we thought, would lead to world-class productivity and passion for quality, and of course, 100% flexibility. This is a greater thing, because once we develop a kind of a cultural platform with so much of positivity and motivation, we thought there will be flexibility to deliver business results. And every change which I need to do, the speed with which I implement changes on my shop floor, the speed with which I can reach the products to the market, the speed with which I can respond to customer demands, I think that kind of a flexibility I can build in my workforce through this model. And of course, this will lead to reinventing the organization on a continuous basis. And ultimately, of course, this is going to make a contribution to society as a better place to live in. So what is this? We actually captioned this model as Blessings. It's just an acronym. We just were brainstorming how to give it a kind of a brand image. We said Blessings stands for building leaders of excellence for social sustainability through inspiring and nurturing Gen Next. Because the prong on which the whole scheme is built is that we are going to tap into the talent, energy, enthusiasm of our youngsters. That is the generation next. So, of course, state government of Uttarakhand translated this into Ashirwad, the Hindi equivalent of blessings. And this is what the state government of Uttarakhand has said in their statement, that this is a great model for bridging disparities and employing rural youth, and it's worthy of implementation in other industries. So what are the objectives of this scheme? We want to enhance the prospects. When I say prospects, it's the employability of the sons of soil, the local people, empowering them with attitude, skills and knowledge, which would qualify them both academically and with hands-on skills to become practicing executives and to grow them into positions of higher responsibilities in nature, because this is something which is not a very kind of academic course. We are looking at basic academic inputs plus supplemented by a very strong dose of experience or on-the-job knowledge which comes only through practice on the shop. Of course, we have taken the local talent. In fact, 100% of the students whom we have engaged through our training partner, they are from local population. Government stipulation is 70%. We said it will be 100%. But this was one of the strong points on which, of course, the government also has consented to the scheme, because they could see the benefit which the local population will reap through this scheme. So industry ready, of course, we want to develop industry ready resources with expertise in modern manufacturing processes and develop them as an integrated workforce, bringing down the divide between management and labor with earned while you learn capabilities. Training is for becoming, of course, the other pitch we made was very strongly was we are not training you to become just what. We are looking at you as future executives of this company. That's the pitch which we have very openly and transparently made. So naturally, the expectations are very high. We are looking at breadth and depth of exposure and skills enrichment. So we are not just training you to become a kind of an operator or a workman with a very, very narrow focus. We are looking at a very, very broad-based training and development which will make you become an executive in the organization. The other features of this scheme was, yes, during this period of training, which is about 4 years, because we normally draft plus two students into this model, there is no employer-employee relationship during these four years, at the years of training. There is, of course, a collaboration with an educational and technical training institute of Vipur. There is, of course, a customized curriculum which integrates classroom learning with shop floor practice. The objective is to transform the potential of a student into an executive potential, and of course we want to skill the unskilled and take him to a managerial level of performance. It's a earn and learn model, because even during the training period there is a stipend paid, and of course this scheme, the idea is that it will help us to develop plug and play talent. And one thought which actually motivated us to look at the scheme very seriously was the kind of students or the products who come out of our technical institutions, even in the best of institutions, are not industry ready. And many times we are spending a lot of time, energy and resources to make them, sometimes to unlearn, sometimes to reorient, and certainly it takes about a year or two before even a good engineering college student becomes industry ready and start contributing. So we thought, why not we even go a little base at the basic level of, let us say, plus two or the school leaving stage, and customize the workforce to our requirements. So to translate this vision, certainly we needed a technical educational partner. We partnered with the NTTF, which has a lot of expertise, proven expertise in this area. They have done a lot of industry specific collaborative programs. So this 4-year diploma program in manufacturing came into being. So we took students with 10 plus 2 background to go through this, and of course they were picked up through a selection process which emphasized on psychometric aptitude and dexterity tests, because that basic aptitude we were looking at before we draft students into this stream. Once selected, they undergo the course at our NTTF's Educational Center. Very unique thing is this NTTF's Educational Center with the lab, well-equipped lab, models, etc. is situated right in the heart of our plant at Pantnagar, inside the AL premises. So in fact, the state government gave permission to us to even set up the center within the factory, though it is actually a factory. Though it is not a part of the factory, honestly speaking, it's an educational center, but the permission was given. And the students do 5 days practical, all practical training at the shop floor, and 1 day classroom sessions where academic inputs are given. There is a good dose of theory plus practice. And there is a blend of academics, practical training, a lot of emphasis on culture building. Of course, we inculcate in them soft skills. We look at the communication. We look at building the confidence. Look at improving the presentation skills. Then we develop computer literacy. In fact, we are given them good grounding in English, because English being the language of technical communication. And these guys certainly have come from a rural backward areas. For them, they can't speak a few words in English when they started the program, but today they can make an hour-long presentations in English, and they can field technical questions, because I can say with a lot of pride how this scheme has transformed this rural youth into very capable, confident people. So what are we trying to do through this Ashirwad? The blessing scheme is to create a new breed of engineers. We call them practicing engineers. And here we wanted to bring in one point very specifically. Yes, we are going to call them executives or engineers, but they are not going to be white collar engineers who will sit in a chair, who will sit before a computer. They are the guys who will be on the shop floor, work on technical problems, work with people, deliver results, demonstrate working on machines if required. So we want to create a practice, or we want to create a new breed of engineers. Practice, we call them as practicing engineers, but we are told our executives in the Pantnagar plant, yes, you should also take pride in being practicing engineers. You should be able to work on machines, demonstrate if required. So we want to bridge up the skill and opportunity gap experienced by society and industry. And this integrated workforce, we are trying to consciously build in a common work culture, common development opportunities. Opportunities to enhance the qualification to level up diploma in manufacturing management. So at the end of 4 years, they get a diploma. I'm very happy to rather share with you that this diploma will be now given by Indira Gandhi National Open University. So it has that stamp of the university also, apart from NTTF AL stamp. So we have been able to elevate it to an university kind of a diploma. So we want to enhance individual professional brand and qualify them to grow into managerial levels. And of course, we have very openly stated that you have an opportunity to get absorbed in AL, Ashok Leyland, in management cadre and not in workman cadre. So the scheme architecture, if you see, there is a four-year model of program. There's a certificate given at the end of 2 years. And why we have said 2 years? 2 years will put them into a certain stage of learning, where they reach certain milestones. If somebody is not able to continue after 2 years, we give them that certificate, because certain milestones in learning are fulfilled. And those who pursue this program further, there are some tight standards also, because this is not just a question of just working, attending classes. There are tests, there's a continuous evaluation both at the shop floor, and there are written exams as well as practicals, and cutoff standards are prescribed. Though we support them to reach those standards, but still 1-2% of the people may not be able to come to standards, which, and we have dropped them. 5 days on the job and 1 day in the classroom. We have a blend of engineering and management inputs, and evaluation is done based on productivity. There is demonstrated productivity on the shop floor, quality norms achieved, and of course academic proficiency. Then we give them a stipend, we call it scholarship. Transport, canteen, welfare facilities are common. Whatever our other executives and employees are enjoying, they have equal access in the factory. The labor laws don't apply to them. That we have said very explicitly, because we are students of the NTTF doing on-the-job training at our shop floor. So there is no employer-employee relationship, but we do take care of the legal requirements which are entailed when somebody works on a shop floor. So we take care of any unforeseen contingencies in the event of a medical or accident help. We certainly have a policy which covers them through NTTF. So this is a little bit broader kind of delving into what kind of a curriculum we have developed. So the engineering part of the curriculum looked at basic science, maths, physics, engineering drawing, manufacturing technology, inputs in electrical electronics, because in today's automobile landscape we find that electrical electronics is going to make a major kind of a impact. So it's no more enough if you are a good mechanical engineer. We also need to pick up the basics of electronics. So that's why the interface of mechanical and electronics is what we call as mechatronics. So mechatronics applications, we give a lot of importance. Material science is taught, automobile engineering, and good dose of practicals which will supplement the theory. Then some basic management inputs we look at. And on the area of attitude and culture building, we look at technical communication, modern shop floor practices, and computer literacy. The skill development happens through, we identify five skill buckets and through which people are exposed. So the areas are broadly machining, assembly, welding, metal finishing, and painting and maintenance. The important fields covered are mechatronics, electrical electronics, pneumatics, and hydraulics. So there is theory, conceptual framework, plus practicals. Then demonstrating the application of principles through work on the shop floor, through actual work, and which is being evaluated by the shop floor supervisors. Then of course we have also looked at exposing them to some of the newer concepts which are being practiced, very contemporary in nature, like lean manufacturing, TPM, Six Sigma, supply chain management, Kaizen, and Kanban. So these concepts are also taught to them with little bit of exposure on the shop floor on application of these concepts. As I told you, the diploma is now elevated in terms of recognition given by IGNOU. So they, after the end of 4-year training, they'll get a diploma, which is a collaborative kind of a certification given by AL-NTTF, which is further stamped with the approval of IGNOU. As I told you, this scheme is not just about empowering people through technical knowledge and skills. We also looked at developing a work culture, which will rather seamlessly integrate with the type of a talent which we are trying to engage in the future. So we have looked at a kind of building a cultural construct and prepare them to get into that cultural construct and design systems and implement them and look at maturing the systems so that these guys at the end of 4 years are able to fit into that kind of a cultural landscape you are envisaging. So we are actually working on developing these people to get into what we call as self-directed work teams. So there are four stages in self-directed work teams which we are covering up in phases. The first thing is team participates and gets involved. So manager provides feedback and recommendations when team organizes work. So the team manages service and quality, leaders manage the boundaries, the second step. Third step is team manages relationships with external agencies, manages budgets with leaders as facilitators. In fact, the last stage, the maturation stage, is team is involved in peer selection, contributes to compensation decisions, and participate in business plans. The idea is we should evolve into the fourth stage, and we are somewhere between second and third stage. So to facilitate this cultural journey, we have looked at several initiatives of involving people, this entity of students. There is the students as a team track what is called the team scorecard, and the key drivers are safety and team performance, quality, productivity, then management of cost and waste, etc. So this is being tracked on a daily basis, and the performance is being discussed and improvement milestones are set up. So what is unique about this scheme is that here you learn while you earn, and of course we do pay a very decent stipend. We don't do it directly, but we do it through NTTF because they are the students of NTTF. And today the stipend, we have started with a stipend of 6,500 or so in the first year. Today we are paying about 8,500 in the third year. Last year they will get up to say something around 11,000 or so. At the end of 4 years, what happens is, yes, they could choose to pursue even other options, because we are not looking at a bond, we are told very clearly. While we would like to give preference to them, because they have been trained by us, they are an important resource, but maybe we may not be able to absorb all of them. So we would rather like them to explore other options also. So we will provide opportunities, and the opportunities in the market and in the industry are also opened up to them, because with such competence and capability building, there won't be any death of opportunities is what we envisage. In fact, we have been telling ourselves the success of this scheme would be at the end of 4 years, we want 80% of these people to be poached by other industries. So that will be validation and proof that this scheme is a very, very strong and robust scheme, and it has achieved its purpose. Of course, there is no employer-employee relationship during these 4 years, and labor laws don't apply. And of course, we have covered them through medical accident insurance, which was a very primary requisite. So a lot of questions have been asked whether this scheme can work in other states. Maybe it has worked in Uttarakhand because there has been a very supportive kind of a government. So some points I thought I should share with the audience, with the practicing HR managers. So some of the very broader philosophical questions I am posing it to you, which we need to consciously take a call on before we look at even designing such a scheme and implementing such a scheme. So if you look at the scheme as a cheap alternative, yes, the scheme will not serve the purpose, because here the cost is much higher and the scheme is to be seen as an investment. It's not a substitute for bringing in cheap labor. So we have not looked at it that way. We have looked at it as a very, very strategic investment in terms of building the skills. In fact, it is costing us double that of a normal resource whom we will bring through other routes. But then we are looking at a very long-term interval. So that's why we are not looking at it as a very cheap substitution of labor. Then other question asked, is it a contrivance to gain immunity from union formation in early stages? Because all of us know that going by the past experiences of union relationship in the early years of a plant, would rather try to avoid a union getting formed in the first 4 or 5 years, because that's the time when you would like to set up your practices, set up your culture, and set up the right practices, set up the right productivity standards, etc. We don't want any negotiations, etc., delay, etc. But okay, this scheme may not give you guarantee against that, but if this scheme is operated well, yes, there is quite a possibility there may not be a need for a union getting formed in the early stages. So this is not a primary objective, but it could be an incidental kind of an objective. Of course, we don't have a union in the first 4 years, but we have not looked at the scheme from that perspective. It is incidental that a union has not formed. But there is no guarantee after these 4 years or in the foreseeable future a union will not get formed, because the group dynamics will dictate that union. But even if a union gets formed, maybe this union is formed from the pool of these people who are very capable and mature, whom we have trained so well, who have a sense of pride in working for the organization. Maybe their ability to even handle a responsibility as union would be much more better and mature than somebody from outside coming in and taking the reins. Of course, this has been proclaimed or heralded as a very important CSR initiative, because what in the backward state of Uttarakhand, where there is a deficit of skills, technical skills, and bridging this deficit through this scheme certainly is going to help the society in a big way and enhance the employability prospects of youth. And in fact, the 1,000-odd students of this scheme who are now engaged with us, they are, most of them are from a very lower socio-economic background. And these are the guys maybe who are not able to pursue the education beyond plus two because of their economic status. And maybe these guys would never have had an opportunity to gain access to technical education but for the scheme. So here we are given an opportunity, provided they have that minimum aptitude to learn. And we have also provided them some kind of a monetary assistance which has helped their families. In fact, the families are very happy. The feedback given by them is this scheme has not only helped them, helped our sons and daughters to gain technical education, it has also supported our family in a very, very meaningful way. Of course, we have taken a road which is less traveled. It has not been traveled at all as far as Pantnagar is concerned, I would say. And of course, this scheme had the support of the state government. State government is still continuing to support us, because they see this as a kind of an initiative which is going to promote employability of local people. In fact, it has now gone to an extent that state government have wound it up. They said it is their scheme. It is no more Ashok Leyland scheme. They have openly proclaimed it that it is an achievement of Uttarakhand government that such a scheme was brought out in collaboration with Ashok Leyland, and government is taking credit for that. And of course, we don't complain too much. We don't protest also, because it's also serving our purpose. In fact, no labor authorities raise a question about this scheme. Though, of course, you will all understand there are gray areas on issues of employer-employee relationship, on issues of applicability of labor laws, but still the state government, having understood the impact and the scope of the scheme, the intentions of the scheme, has almost adopted, I would say, a hands-off approach as far as labor authorities are concerned. They don't intervene, or they don't try to, they have not asked any questions about the implementation of the scheme. So the high point we reached when we signed a memorandum of understanding between Ashok Leyland, NTTF and state government with a very broad roadmap, what are the role of stakeholders, rights and obligations. These have been formally built into and subscribed by the party, and government is a party to this scheme. And what it means to those who are now students is, yes, there's a very great feedback which is very heartening. And in fact, taking a leaf from our model, the Uttarakhand state government has opened up what is called a UTK Open University, which follows a similar model of industry institute collaboration, where students are given theoretical inputs, then they are sent to industry for two and a half years to gain on-the-job knowledge. So this is another extension of our efforts, I would say. Government has blessed it. They have started something on their own to increase or diversify or broaden the skill base. So this is just a one letter which the Chief Minister, the then Chief Minister of Uttarakhand, had written to Mr. Sesh Rai, our Managing Director at that point of time when we inaugurated the plan. He says, thank you very much for launching the scheme, blessings. I am sure this scheme will go a long way in ensuring employment for hill folks in far-flung areas. I deeply appreciate involving my advisor. In fact, he has put his advisor on the whole process. He is a part of the committee which oversees the implementation. I am hopeful we can set this as an example for others to follow. So this is a kind of a recognition which we got from state government. And this was some of the press clippings which talked about our Ashirwad scheme. This is the picture of beaming young people who are showing the victory sign, I would say. And of course, these fresh young people are going to be the future of Uttarakhand, I have no doubt about that. So I thought I will also answer some of the questions which generally come to our mind when we operate a scheme like this. In fact, these questions we brainstormed and then answered it in our own way before even we inaugurated the scheme. And some of the grey areas and doubts that will come in anybody's mind when you try to take a road which has not been traversed so far. So this is a kind of a very complex kind of a relationship. We have an industry as Ashok Leyland. And there is a technical educational partner, which is NTTF, and there are students. So what is the relationship between these three? And what are their rights and duties? And in the event of any doubts and clarifications, who is the authority? How they will be clarified? What will be the management structure? What will be the management authority? Then we say the labor laws don't apply. We say there is no employer-employer. So on day-to-day basis, when operational issues arise, when gray areas come, who will resolve what? And who will take the responsibility? And where the primary responsibility will lie? So where people can look forward to in getting guidance? So we try to answer these questions. First, we ourselves raise these questions. Then we try to answer them in a meaningful way to the extent possible. Then we have shared it with our plant managers and line managers who will be engaging these students. So that they are also asked to very clear during these 4 years what is expected of them and what is expected of the students. So who is the employer for this? We call them executive apprentices or NTTF students. Yes, they will be on the payroll of the training institute and paid a consolidated stipend generally in line with the organization compensation paid to workmen and trainees in the industry. So the status is mainly students. So there is no question of employer-employee relationship with them. Who will control these students or executive apprentices? Don't confuse these executive apprentices with apprentices under Apprentices Act. This is nothing, this is not an arrangement under Apprentices Act. We just call them executive apprentices just to distinguish them from other types of trainees and apprentices. The training institute, yes, will be the sole controlling agency of these executive apprentices or students and will be responsible for governing the training, assessment and continuance. On completion of 4-year diploma program, executive apprentices will be absorbed. Have the opportunity to be absorbed as executives in any one of the Ashok Leyland units or in any of the areas like marketing also, and there will be a probation, etc., on meeting selection criteria. So who will take care of the academics during this 4-year training program? There will be a customized curriculum which will be delivered by the institute, which is NTTF. Infrastructure support is given by AL. Ashok Leyland executives can participate in executive. We are looking at 1-day contact classes per week. Who will take care of technical and functional training? Yes, AL exclusively or jointly. It's more hands-on and on the job. And of course, as designed by AL in consultation with HTM. Practical training, we have a greater role to play because we know what is required by us. An academic part is generally taken care by HTM. So who will decide on productivity level? This is a very interesting concept because this training looks at on-the-job training on the shop floor for a major part of the training duration. It's about 5 days in a week where the guys, the boys and girls have to be on the shop floor, work on machines, deliver output as per the productivity and quality standards. So Ashok Leyland will have a greater role to play as far as the shop floor training is concerned. So there will be time standards, there will be engagement time, there will be machine utilization norms. This, all this will be formed part of the assessment of the student. Those who do not meet the student standards after giving fair opportunity will have to be discontinued. Who will decide on work methods and processes? Yes, AL will decide, modify, there is total flexibility. Who will decide the work schedules? It's AL again exclusively as per the business requirements, normally on 4.5 to 5 day basis as far as OJT or on the job training is concerned. Who will decide the code of conduct and rules of discipline? AL and the institute will jointly do that. All AL specific requirements will be incorporated in this code of conduct. Will the code of conduct be common for executive apprentices and executives? Yes. Executives will have to do the role modeling. So do you differentiate between executives, campus recruits like executive trainees, that is DETs, DETs, MBA and executive apprentices? Yes, we are moving towards an integrated workforce. Compensation may vary, but anything related to targets, conduct, facilities and overall culture will be commonly applicable. The hierarchy will not work in its conservative sense, but in terms of more experienced people coaching the freshers. Regular executives should be in a position to demonstrate productivity by working on missions and by following all work methods. In fact, to bring that kind of pride in being practicing engineers, we said our regular executives also should work on missions and demonstrate productivity, not every day, but at least a certain part of the time to bring in the right type of the role model. Or the apprentices or the executive apprentices are expected to follow instruction as part of acquiring knowledge and skills? Yes. Performance, yes, there is a very rigorous performance kind of a performance evaluation. So the training goals are specified, which relate to academics as well as performance in terms of productivity levels, volumes and quality norms achieved on the shop floor. So in this context, the executives, our regular executives, will be acting as instructors on the shop floor, and faculty from NTTF will handle the sessions at our training center. Executive trainees through campus will follow their own training plan within common code of conduct. Who will take administrative actions against violation of any kind? Of course, Ashok Leyland will provide inputs, but it's the institute which will evaluate and take final action. Representative of the institute will always be on campus full time. In fact, we have full time faculty also apart from administrator on the campus. In fact, the campus itself is in the Ashok Leyland factory premises. Who will evaluate the performance of the students? Institute will evaluate based on inputs from Ashok Leyland. Who will pay their salary or stipend, or we call it a scholarship? Institute will pay their stipend or scholarship. They will establish their own payroll and make the payment. Who will decide the salary increase? There's no salary increase. It will be a stipend. Of course, we are looking at increasing the stipend year after year. It will be decided by the institute in consultation with AL, will correspond to applicable benchmark in the industry. Who will resolve the grievances? Yes, the institute will lead the process. Yale will provide solutions on issues in their purview. Can institute overrule Yale perspective? Yale is the client of the institute. Institute is the service provider. The mutuality will provide. Who will mediate in case of a dispute between the institute and Ashok Leyland? There will be a governing body of the institute and Ashok Leyland involving senior people. That decision will be final. Who has the final say in resolving the conflict between, in the case of a conflict between the institute and Ashok Leyland? As customer, it will be our option to continue with the arrangement or not. In case of any breaking off, there will be on the basis of pre-decided conditions. Will institute have an establishment on the premises of AL? Yes, an office to house the staff. And also, I am very glad to share with you that in the last 1 year, about a year back, we had decided and we have built a hostel also for girls, exclusively for girl students within our active premises, because we felt it's not safe and secure for girls to stay outside. And looking at the kind of working hours and the engagement they have on the shop floor followed by classroom sessions, we thought it is our bounden duty to take care of them, though they are not our employees. So we have put up a very nice girls hostel, we have invested in it, there is a warden, so that we take care of them. Safety and security during this 4 year training. So this is also something very unique, I would say. Apart from that, a kind of educational center within the premises, we have also put up a girls hostel. What will be the role of HR department? HR will be the process owner for establishing the arrangement with the institute. It will be a co-owner with the functional heads or shop floor heads for establishing 21st century factory code. Then there is an area where how Ashok Leyland executives deal with the students, because they need to oversee, supervise, evaluate them when they work on the shop floor, when they undergo on-the-job training on the shop floor. So what is the kind of differentiation or the mutuality or overlap between institute staff or AL HR or our line managers? So AL HR or the HR department will manage the issues with the institute, and they will create the right interface between the institute or line managers and AL. What will be the one important question that always would arise in the mind of people is, what will be the perspective on labor laws, and will labor authorities still be involved? Strictly speaking, the labor laws will not directly apply in this situation. Our memorandum of understanding with the government specifies it. This has been accepted and consented by the state government, including the labor authorities. But the Chief Labour Commissioner of Uttarakhand had given a specific no objection certificate to the basic postulates of the scheme, which was returned formally, and we sought his permission. Of course, having said that, I can't say that, yes, we are very, very 100%, nothing can happen. We are on a very, very safe wicket. We will need to test the situation. So far, it has been so good, I would say. Has been gone according to the plan in the last 3 years. However, the institute will be governed by certain laws, and those will apply more in the nature of shops and establishment and university rules. However, we need to ensure that minimum safety, welfare, minimum wages, factories, etc. related conditions are followed. In fact, we are following, we are exceeding the norms set on enhanced basis. All the labor laws which relate to factory establishment, facilities, license, etc. will still apply. Only those in the nature of PF, ESI, etc. will not apply because they are not being paid salaries and they are not employees of our establishment. So where do we go from here? So taking on the strengths and learning from the strengths, and how do we build the strengths we have acquired by working on the scheme? We think that we need to further strengthen the initiative. We started with 200 students. Today we are about 1,200 students. I think this is the more kind of optimum level which we needed to reach, which we have reached. And at the end of 4 years, yes, we need to, which will come next year, at least the first batch of about 300, 400 students would be getting the diploma. At least a year earlier now, we have started looking at what will be the opportunities for them within our plant, in different areas, maybe in plants outside Uttarakhand, and even in areas like service and marketing. In fact, we are tweaking the curriculum in the last year to look at making it little more, I would say, adaptable to requirements in our frontline marketing areas like service. So some of this talent can go to frontline service force also. And of course, as I said, the strength of this scheme would be validated when these guys become more and more wanted in the market and in the industry, who would not like to employ or engage such capable people with the right type of knowledge and skills, with a very such a strong dose of practice on the shop floor along with theoretical inputs, which you won't get from academic institutions. I think they are going to serve the industry well. And we have now a very strong hope and expectation that they will be picked up by other industries also. That will be a very good sign that this scheme is doing well and its robustness is getting established. Suddenly it is a next industry practice in skill development. We would like to see more of this happening in other industries and in other states, especially with the depth of skills and the kind of huge requirements we have and our technical education institutions, neither in terms of capability, neither in terms of faculty support and infrastructure, won't be able to support such a big growth and ambitious agenda of skill development. And industry has a very important role to play, and I think we have done a bit of it by engaging ourselves in this scheme. Then getting, of course, the quality students has been a huge challenge, because I, in fact, in my earlier, when I started the whole presentation, I just talked about the kind of a context in Uttarakhand where even at plus two level, we don't have mathematics as a subject. 80% of students have not undertaken mathematics. In fact, we had to do a bridge course to give them the basics. Then gender diversity is another area we focused upon. I'm very glad to share with you that about 20% of the students whom we have recruited, about 200 of them are girls. And in fact, they are even excelling the boys in terms of demonstrating the proficiency and on the job knowledge on the shop floor. Yes, legally one can say there are some gray areas, like on the employer-employee relationship, on application of labor laws, and what is the exposure we have because we are involving students, they are contributing to production directly, what legal implication does it bring? Yes, these are some gray areas which we discussed. But we have taken a plunge, and if the situation warrants certain mid-course corrections, we may have to do it, but then we thought we'll bite the bullet because we thought that the intentions are very clear. The intentions are not with the view to exploit people. The intentions are to really develop skills and knowledge amongst a wider population, wider strength of the population, which will serve the industry, not only us, but the industry in the long run. So role modeling on developing these executives will be with our line managers, who has to take pride in technical knowledge and skills. And of course, as I told you, it was not all very, it's not a bed of roses. It was not at all hunky-dory to start with, I would say. All the risks in taking a road less traveled was there. All the doubts were there in our mind. legal implications, yes, we spent a lot of time, and we did not get 100% answers or safe answers to the questions. But with a certain belief in ourselves and with the support we got from the government, state government, we thought we will venture upon this, which we have done. And of course, I should appreciate our technical training partner, NTTF, who also have risen to the occasion and were very adaptable and flexible, who have co-owned this vision of bringing into mainstream people who are skilled and bringing out the end products from a very, very raw students into a kind of fully fledged, technically skilled professionals at the end of 4 year term. So we are of course looking at replicating this model at other units and in new ventures. Some fledgling experiments are taking place. In fact, in one of our other units at Alwar, we are in discussions with the state government of Rajasthan to look at developing a model, a similar model. And the government has shown interest and the blueprint is ready. Let us see how it goes. This in short is what I would like to share with you, and thank you for your patience.
Now, questions, please. You can ask
now questions, please. I'll be very happy to share my thoughts and experiences. How do you answer?
You can speak it out. You can speak out. You just read out the question from who has asked the question and then give a clarification.
What is the question? I'm not able to understand.
Will you please share the question? I'll read out the question for you. Okay, we have a question. One is, hello Pranit from Tally Solutions here. Good afternoon. There's no question to it. Will you share your PowerPoint presentation? Yeah, from CIA Secretary,
yeah,
we'll send
we
it. We'll do that to Swati Wadekar. We have your email ID. We'll send it to you. Arun Kumar has asked a question. Areas which need clarity are, since the executive assistants are involved in production activities, what is the guarantee that sometimes later PF or ESI or Labor Department will not raise an issue over PF, ESI and bonus coverage? Second question in the same area is, what will be the cost of infrastructure approximately for setup of 50 students? Third question is, having a mix of on-roll workers and EA will lead to issues in the long term in terms of salary benefit comparisons. Engaging females in industry like ours, there is no guarantee of job opportunities after completion of diploma. These are questions from Arun Kumar. Yeah, I think that.
I would like to answer these questions in the best possible way. So the first question was, since EAs are involved in production activities, what is the guarantee that sometime later PF, ESI or Labor Department will not raise an issue of PF, ESI and bonus coverage? It's a good question, and we have deliberated on it before we started the scheme. Yes, certain element of grey area is there, but considering that this scheme is aimed at developing the skills, a certain degree of on-the-job training also becomes important, because it's not a kind of an academic kind of a program we are looking at. These academic inputs have to be supported by on-the-job training, which can happen only on the shop floor. So to that extent, I think there is a relevance of the shop floor training, which is inbuilt into the curriculum. And in fact, this we have put it as a part of our scheme, you know, proposal to the state government, and state government has agreed with that. Totally, that labor laws will not apply, and our experiment in the last 3 years has been, we have not got any interference or any objection from labor authorities, because the state government has bought into this scheme, has understood the implications of the scheme, and they don't see it as an exploitative kind of a model. And what will be the, of course, whether other state governments also will give permission, will support, it's a moot question. We have to see how it evolves. But I think this is a wonderful, it's a model which needs to be actually widely shared with other state governments, and tell them, give them that confidence that yes, see, a government, state government of Uttarakhand has been able to support this scheme, then why not mature states not able to do that, you know? In fact, we should give them that confidence, yes, It is within the ambit of law. It can be done. It serves a larger social purpose. I think we need to sell this scheme to other governments and look at getting their help in terms of further spread and further patronage of these schemes. What will be the cost of, next question is, what will be the cost of infrastructure approximate for setup with 50 students? And again, it's very difficult for me to hazard a guess, because for us, I would can roughly say it depends on the nature of industry, on the skill inputs you are trying to give, and how in-depth the skill inputs are going to be. For us, of course, each student, I would say roughly, our cost is about 12,000 per month for about 4 years. So 12,000 means about 1,20,000 in a year. So for 4 years, we are spending about something around 5 to 5.5 lakhs on each student. That is roughly the estimate. Apart from that, of course, we have invested in lab and all that, which would have costed us maybe a few lakhs, another 3-4 lakhs. Having a mix of, the next question is, having a mix of on-roll workers and executive apprentices, will lead to issues in the long run in terms of salary benefits comparisons? Yeah, there could be issues, but then one has to be really very, very clear about where you want to take these students at the end of 4 years, what will be the skill levels, what will be the skill proficiency, what career growth you have for them. We need to have that blueprint ready before we even venture into the scheme. So this we have done an elaborate work. In fact, before we started the scheme, we are very, very clear at the end of 4 years, which level and with what salary level they will get into, and what will be the career growth in the next 4-5 years, and how do they stack up against regular diploma holders and degree engineers. Suddenly there will be a differentiation amongst these three levels, and that we have very clearly thought out. And to the best of our ability, I think we have plotted their salary levels, career growth, etc., which I think we will be able to justify. And the next is, engaging females in industry like ours, there is no guarantee of job opportunities after completion of diploma. As far as females or girls are there, in fact, we are for diversity and in diversity, because we want to increase the number of girls in our industry. In fact, the challenge we face is the supply chain itself is not adequate. When I go to engineering colleges, I go to polytechnics, the number of girls who have taken mechanical engineering as the stream of specialization, the number is rather very limited, I would say, because they prefer electronics, IT and all that. So it's not that the industry cannot absorb them. The industry has requirements. In fact, no more that stereotype that, you know, it's a kind of a male-dominated industry, that, you know, the dirty shop floors and, you know, manual work, you know, those kind of stereotypes are long gone. Now we are looking at very modern shop floors, driven by robotics, driven by CNC machines. So here, actually the gender doesn't matter at all. In fact, girls can do a much better work, because here it calls for certain intellectual inputs, certain degree of focus and dexterity, which girls are good at. So in fact, girls are very eminently suitable. In fact, our experience with this blessing scheme is that we have about 20% of them, 200 girls, who are doing job which is not just comparable to their male counterparts. In fact, they are exceeding their male counterparts also in many areas. So our response to this question is that it's not a problem. We can guarantee jobs. Opportunities are plenty. As long as people are willing to learn and take up the responsibility, I don't see death of opportunity. I find that enlightened, progressive organizations in auto field, they are also looking very consciously to improve this gender diversity. Next question. It's a very good and unique initiative. Your presentation was quite exhaustive. Thank you very much. Here is wishing you for continued success. Thank you, Major Bhargava, for your nice comments. And I think we are committed to making this scheme a success, and our efforts are continuing in that direction, and I will be very happy to share this experience with others also, because we feel it's a very unique model which can reap very good benefits to the industry as well. Next question is from Kirti Vardhana. Our comments are thanks. Very insightful talk. Question is, can Mr. Muralidharan elaborate on how AL has chosen and incorporated the work areas and processes that the executive apprentices work on while they are studying? Maybe some examples of some processes they work on during the 4 years. Good question. I have shared a very broad perspective on which are the skill buckets we are looking at. And I think in this presentation it may be a little difficult to go further deep into it. But I am open to a kind of maybe a little more deeper discussion offline. If you would like to contact me, we can share also. Possibly you can even visit our plant or talk to or interact with our people and experts to get a little more insight into how the whole thing is happening. This is from Sirisha. This is a very good initiative indeed. How difficult would it be to bring the scheme to all the plants? Example for the one in the soul. A very good question, very good thought. Yes, it's going to be a little difficult because the older plants are frozen in terms of certain culture and attitude. Though we are trying to change, some changes are happening. But the opportunity to replicate a scheme in a older plant maybe certainly it's not there right now. But then in future, possibly with the attrition of workforce, with people superannuating, in future maybe we can think of this scheme, bring in people in this and get acceptance. But having said that, yes, there are going to be certain cultural issues which need to be addressed, which will take some time before we can introduce a scheme of this sort in an older plant. Ilangovan of Titan is asking, what are the other industries who have implemented the scheme in Pantnagar? I don't think anybody has tried this out, though all of them have come and visited us, have understood, tried to understand. But right now, I don't think anybody has taken on the scheme in a big way, but maybe in future I wish or I hope that people will get the confidence to try out. Better still, I would feel that the products of this scheme, if they work in other industries, possibly the scheme will get again wider acceptance, because they will be able to see for themselves what the students can achieve at the end of 4 years and how they are different from others. So that will be really the proof of the skills and competences which the scheme has brought about. And we are going to encourage that. In fact, we want to encourage outplacement. We want good number of people to leave us. Though, of course, they are very good resources, we have invested, we would like them to work in other industries and demonstrate the impact of the scheme. What are the other industries implemented? I was told, okay. Then Ilangovan has got another question. Is it possible to start other branches of discipline like mechanical, electrical, etc.? Mr. Ilangovan, all said and done, this is we are more customizing it to our industry's requirements, to Ashok Leyland and broadly I would say auto industry. So if it is within that scope and purview, yes, why not? My take would be on that way. But maybe we may not be able to do like an academic institution. We don't want to start a course to just for the sake of diversification, because we are not in the business of academics. We are in the business of trying to, I would say that, build knowledge and skills and competences which is going to serve the industry in the long run. We are looking at that kind of objective in mind. Another question from Mr. Ilangovan is this trainees allowed to work on machines in the shop floor? If they are allowed to work on machines, is it legally okay? Well, the scheme allows them to work on machines in the shop floor. We certainly give them orientation and training. Safety measures and safety appliances are given. They are also taught how to do the work safely. Then, so far we have not encountered any legal challenge. And of course, the other advantage we have in a plant like Pantnagar is most of the machines have a kind of advanced technology where it is all numerically controlled, or we have robotics, etc., which means that the job becomes that much more easier and safety is inbuilt into this process and machines.
you could also clarify that this runs on a shift based system, right? You have three shifts or something like that?
Yeah, we also work on a shift basis, and some of the students will come on shift also. So as far as learning is concerned, it is actual work. They learn through working actually on the shop floor. It is not just a simulation.
Yeah, it's all.
One gets the full exposure to what happens on the shop floor if you have to work there. There are no compromises made on that because they are students. Except that we look at giving them some induction and orientation, which will take about a fortnight to a month before they are put on the shop
floor. Actual shop floor.
In fact, another interesting thing I can share with you is that there are a lot of skeptics when we try to introduce this scheme, even within our own people, within our own senior technical people. So in fact, there was a lot of little bit of field, I would say, cynicism, that you are bringing in the latest technology, but then you want plus two students to operate the latest technology. So being an engineering company with engineers, graduate engineers and postgraduates in engineering, how can you just even such a thought would cross your mind that you can look at people who are coming from school will operate such machines. So we countered it by saying, let us try out. How much time realistically it will take for somebody to get the real feel and orientation to shop floor? We found that it took about 1 month, not even 1 month. 10 days is was what it took to really to get an orientation.
It's a very good example.
And 1 month is maybe in a very difficult or a complex area. That has been our experience. In fact, these people have operated the machines in the last 3 years with utmost higher level, I would say. There have been no accidents. And another thing which I should say is that we involve these guys not only just on the shop floor. This thing, whatever is happening within the company, be it quality contest, be it the quality month, be it kind of quality circles, be it intra-unit competitions on quality or problem solving, these guys get into it. We allow them, encourage them. In fact, when I was in PNR Pantnagar last few months back, we had this quality month. This entity of students staged a play on the shop floor, and look at, as they call it, you know, street play, on demonstrating what quality is. So they themselves had written the script, they acted on it, they brought out what is quality, what are the 7 QC tools, what is the attitude to quality. Everything was brought out very so very nicely. The whole thing was done by them, scripted by them, acted out by them. Very powerful message they brought. So one interesting thing is, these guys, apart from getting the technical knowledge and skills, they are also growing themselves, I think, in terms of personality.
Personality growth.
Personality growth has been tremendous in the last 2-3 years.
Confidence
is growing. And from a situation where they can't speak few words in English, from a situation where they can't speak to a group of people, today they make very effective presentations in English. On top of it, they can clarify also technical questions in English. I'm so very comfortable and confident in terms of communication. I think this is something which the scheme has built into them. So that's another interesting.
Maybe 10 years down the line, you will find real stars and gems coming out of this program.
And we are very sure out of these 1,000, at least 10-15% are really, will be very outstanding.
We form the nucleus.
People all are good, but 10-15% I think will be very outstanding. And that sparks we are able to see right. And maybe those are the guys whom we would like to retain, because we also do a continuous evaluation and tracking process.
Are there any more questions? Well, if there are no more questions, I would just like to give a concluding thank you. I would like to thank Mr. Muralidharan for having spared the time and come and given us such an elaborate presentation, which has cleared almost all the doubts and made this program a sort of people could look at it seriously. I would like to thank him on behalf of CII for an excellent presentation, and I would also tell him that we have taken it up with the Tamil Nadu Skill Mission. We also facilitated a visit to Saint Gobain to see this LWE which is being implemented in Sriperumbudur. We also tried to talk to the Karnataka state government about the scheme, and we will request Ashok Leland for further help in pushing this program with the state governments and getting them sort of a legal sanctity like how it has been done in Uttarakhand. Thank you very much, sir, for this excellent presentation. I'm sure the audience has benefited a lot from this presentation. We at CII also have benefited a lot from this presentation. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much for this opportunity. It was wonderful sharing this experience with all of you. Any further questions or clarifications, feel free to contact me. And if some of you want to visit our plant, because seeing is believing, because whatever I can talk here, so however, with great conviction I have been trying to talk, because I have been a part of the scheme in implementing the scheme. And I am seeing in front of my own eyes how the scheme is evolving and its visible benefits. Some of you who are interested in seeing how it is working out in the real, at the ground level, you are also free to visit our plant. Please get in touch with me. We can organize such a visit and you can meet the students and our people. And it will be of great interest to interact with them to get an understanding of what has happened and is there something happening which is really different from what has been the conventional model in our industries. So thank you so much for your participation and the kind of incisive questions you have asked. And I'm open to any further interaction with you in clarification or in terms of sharing.
So we will share the presentation with all the participants and further clarifications can be taken from Mr. Muralidharan.
So thank you very much.